welcome to the sleepy town of Winchester, an English idyll on the edge of the South Downs National Park. A place where you can while away your time, absorbing the history of the area, the beauty of the countryside, or just grabbing yourself a pint in a traditional English pub. However, once and only once every year, the sound of birdsong is replaced by something a little bit more exciting as MXGP rolls into town. Rocketing towards the midway point of the championship with a rush of races coming thick and fast. This is where riders need to dig in and grind out those championship points in each and every moto, especially here at the epic track, which is Matterley Basin. For you guys at home, sit back and enjoy the show.
Max Anstey, Monster Energy DRT Kawasaki, number 99.
Steven Frossard, number 183, arrive for KTM Vilvo for Trent.
Down the start straight then, nice and wide here at Matterley Basin into a long sweeping left-hander, slightly banked to the outside this year as we exit turn one. Down the straight, there's your foxhole shot line just before they drop into turn two, which is a downhill 90 degree right-hander through a slight kink before going through the bottom of the valley and then over the three waves into turn three, the right-hander. Second, third gear, stepping down, hard on the brakes. There'll be some gnarly braking bumps at the bottom of the hill. Exit turn four, over a step up, and Max Anstey, as you can see, savoring the atmosphere here, taking a very novel approach to the GoPro lap. Down the first of the major step downs before doubling up for the first time into the left-hander, the banked 180. If you go wide, you can triple down the hill. Some riders can even do it from the inside, but then this is a triple single or a quad section, heading back uphill into the main spectator area. Exit the turn into the left. Again, if you go to the outside, you can triple, double your way into the combination through the series of waves on the opposite side of the valley. Then this left-hander off cambered uphill, easy on the gas, over a single. And then the lines will really start to switch up here as the weekend goes on as well. Some riders might go wide, cut to the inside, over the double jump there, and set themselves up for a pass in what is possibly the most technical corner on the circuit, the long off-cambered right-hander, turn 14. Starts to even out just a little bit, but then at that point it goes left. We drop down even further. Huge step down into the bottom of the valley once more. And then this banked right-hand turn, dropping down again over the Ippon step up. They've built the landing up this year, so you have to be a little bit more on point with your landing. Exit the left, and then this is the huge uphill triple jump. Some riders go double single to the inside, but you can triple all the way and make the inside as well. But there is a bank to the outside just in case you run wide. The finish corner, off cambered uphill through the right-hander over the Monster Energy finish line jump here. Nice big double. And then over the Dragon's Back, down past pit lane, through the right, across the start straight, and we start another lap here at Matterley Basin.
This is the Vodka Nightclub in Winchester. I'm going to have a sneak peek of the 2016 Fox range before we speak to one of their athletes, Evgeny Bobryshev.
Hello.
Well, that's a really impressive Fox Flex Air range in there, isn't it? But it's good to get out in the fresh air and talk a little bit about your season so far. Round seven, and you're sixth in the championship, and you've had very good, consistent moto finishes. If someone had said that to you at the beginning of the year, would you take that over maybe a couple of podiums?
Yeah, for me, it's I had one goal this year, coming into this year, like to be consistent, because taking all the past years, I had lots of injuries, lots of crashes, so I was up and down. So for me, it's better to be consistent, get maybe close to the podium, but get good points for the championship. In the race, I just want to get a rhythm. I want to just do everything clear and without any stupid mistakes. Just want to look consistent, you know, a really smooth and nice at the track. That's what at the moment I'm doing. So that's good for me because I'm making my goal in the right direction.
And I guess that comes with the experience that you have, the experience in the sport.
Yeah, it is, for sure, because it's been already from 2011, it wasn't such a good year, so I had to do some changing to get back.
And you have a family. How do you get that balance right between your work and your personal life? Is it difficult?
Good question.
Good question.
We have to think. No, it's not really difficult because I have a good wife. She's really helping a lot with. She's taking care of the baby. I mean, like when I'm busy with the training and races, because we're quite tight with the time. Like all week training, the weekend racing. You know, the week training again. For sure, like don't think that I don't have a time for my family. We have a good time out of on the free day. We're traveling together with the baby, and my baby, you know, it's really easy baby and funny traveling. We call her travel baby, you know. So she's, I can be always concentrated in my races. So when I'm away, I get clear my mind, everything, and then I'm really fresh for the race.
Thank you. So motocross isn't just about racing on the weekends. It's about putting in the work in the off season and weeks away and simply enjoying the pleasures of riding a motorcycle fast. That other side of it has been captured perfectly in the new film Fear Not by Mikey Neal and Monster Energy. I'm going to watch the premiere now before the racing gets underway in MX2 Race 1.
First time this year, Jeffrey Herlings failed to win the qualifying race. The Dutchman still suffering the effects of the crash from 2 weeks ago. In Spain, instead, it was Valentin Guillo that was fastest and could be one to look out for in the main race. Max Anstey, though, crossed the foxhole shot line for the first time this year, but it was Pauls Jonas who found his way into the lead almost immediately. But Anstey responded. It wasn't long before he started to pull clear of the rest of the field. Jonas did well to hang on in second, but then he stalled the machine, allowing Valentin Guillo to go through. Jonas lost positions and dropped back to fourth. As a poor starting, Jordi Tixier had to work his way through traffic, first overtaking Jeremy Siwa to get himself into seventh. And then he passed his young American teammate to go fifth. And that's where Jordi Tixier would stay. Max Anstey, though, buoyed by the support from the local crowd, was doing his best to not disappoint. But in the second half of the race, Valentin Guillo was proving to be a thorn in the Brit's side. On several occasions, the Swiss Yamaha rider tried to make a move, and with two laps to go, he thought he'd made the move stick. But the two riders got tangled at the bottom of the hill, and from out of nowhere, Jeffrey Herlings sprung a surprise attack, first finding his way past Guillo and then past Anstey. who in turn was undone by Guillaume. And all that happening in the final couple of laps. But with Geoffrey Herlings taking the checkered flag, he extended his lead in the championship, and Max Nagel will be looking to do the same in MXGP.
Max, with all your race wins, I've spoken to you more than any other rider in the paddock, but you always seem generally pleased to be there and thrilled to be interviewed. Is that the case?
Yeah, I like it, because that's a bit paying off, you know, when you make good results. People start being interested in you. And when we said, like, in the winter, it was all about Tony and Filippotto, nobody was talking about me or us. So I always say that action speaks louder than words. And now I finally could make some good results and the people start asking. So it's nice, I like it, yeah.
Now, you mentioned results. I know in the past they haven't always been that great because you suffered a lot with illnesses, not just injuries, but illnesses. What gets you through that tough time?
Yeah, it's true. That was a difficult time. And it was for a couple of years I had that illness, what I didn't know. It was about food. And I've been to so many doctors and going everywhere and asking if somebody can help me. Nobody could find any solution for it. And at once just a simple house doctor, he said, make this kind of test. And for the food I make it, and they said, you're allergic about this food, this food, and this food. And that's what I was always eating during the weekend, especially. And that was making me so tired always. And then I stopped it, and it makes me so much better now. And I could also learn a lot from it, that there's food like what sport people should eat, what is really healthy for your body, but if you're allergic about it, then yeah, you should not.
How's the bike changed? How's the bike different now to what the bike was like when you first put your leg over it?
It's a lot smaller. Like when I started, bike was really high for me because I'm a really small guy. And then we changed a lot to make it really low. And also my setting is quite special. So, and strong engine, what I really like. So the bike fits really perfect to me now.
Thank you. Let's see if Max can keep his run going in MXGP race one.
Max Nagel could only qualify fourth as Tony Cairoli romped to his second qualifying race win on the 450 in successive races. Nagel fell on the opening lap, handing the lead to Tony Cairoli and Clemondo Sound. Davide Guarnieri, though, fell and the race was red flagged. Eventually he did sit up and was okay, but that meant the riders had to go back to the waiting zone. And for the first time this year, they would be forced into a situation where they would have to have a full restart, the race almost going half distance. Stephen Frossard went too early and hit the gate as Tony Cairoli charged into turn one, well clear of everybody else, taking the foxhole shot from Sean Simpson. Clemondo Sal was well placed in third, and Max Nagel the beneficiary of that red flag situation because he was in fifth, but not long after that he was up into fourth, chasing Clemondo Sal. Sean Simpson was in second position, keeping at bay DeSalle and Nagel as David Philippots soon came under pressure from Gauthier Paulin, who survived a little scare. But that mistake allowed Fevre to find his way past the Italian. Mistakes all over the place for the championship leading duo of Nagel and DeSalle. But eventually they closed in on Sean Simpson. DeSalle found his way into second with this pass on the Scott. And it wasn't long before Nagel followed. So Cairoli led the way on the 2-2-2. DeSalle was then second. And Nagel third. Simpson running a very credible fourth place. In the background, the red HRC colours of Evgeny Bobrishev got himself into fourth position after he found his way past the 24 of Simpson. Gauthier Paulin tried next, but the Frenchman had to settle for sixth. Cairoli, though, was in a class of his own and was well clear of DeSalle towards the end of the race, leaving the battle for second between DeSalle and Nagel. And despite his efforts, the German couldn't quite get close enough despite setting the fastest lap on the penultimate lap. But the win would eventually fall to Cairoli. DeSalle was second, Nagel was third.
Welcome back to Matterley Basin with a rather crooked Nathan Watson. Nathan, when are we going to see you back on the bike?
Well, I've had the all clear from the doctor, so it's just basically they've said whenever I feel up to it, I can get back on the bike. So it's still a little bit weak, you know, as you'd expect, but hopefully in the next couple of weeks I'll start riding again.
Now, I know last year you made the move from a British team to a factory team in MXGP. Just describe how difficult that was and what challenges you faced.
Yeah, it was a really big step, as you can imagine, you know. I went from being the only MX1 rider on a team, you know, a British-based team, just doing British championships, you know. It was just a fun time, not much pressure. You know, I was like at the top of my game in the British championship, well, not in the British championship, but yeah, I was, you know, one of the top riders and stepped into the MXGP, and obviously, you know, it was a massive step. The guys were a lot faster, it was a lot tougher, and obviously I felt more pressure riding for a factory team, but you know, I just tried to enjoy it and make the most of it, and yeah, it went really good.
And something you can make the most of is having a teammate like Max. Just how helpful is it to have him here and to learn from him? I mean, does he actually help you out at all?
Yeah, Max is great, you know. I learned so much from him because he's had so much experience over the years. He's been in the game for so long. He's such a nice guy. He helped me out anything I need, anything I want to know, you know.
Like, what advice would he give you?
Well, just how to prepare, you know, training and riding. And he don't have to actually explain stuff to me because I can just watch him, and you know, I learn a lot from just watching what he does. He's so focused on his job, and yeah, it's a real good teammate to have.
Thank you. Nathan's brother Ben also races, but in MX2, alongside another British hopeful, Max Anstey. Let's see how they both get on in MX2 race 2.
Anstey was looking for a good start, like he got in race one. But as he charged down into turn one, it was apparent that that good start never happened. He was pushed wide through the first corner. And up the inside, it was the two factory Red Bull KTMs of Jonas and Herlings that crossed the Foxhole Shop line first. But then they ran each other wide, allowing Valentin Guillot, number 92, an easy route into first place. Tixier survived what could have been a horrible crash at the bottom of the first hill. But he did survive in fourth behind Jonas and Herlings. Jonas in third position. Soon came under pressure though from number one, Jordi Tixier and Jeremy Siwa. But a slight mistake entering the wave section allowed the Frenchman, the defending champion, into third place. Valentin Guillot had his time at the front, but was under pressure from Jeffrey Herlings, who thought he made this pass stick for the lead. But after his speed in race one, Guillot responded immediately and was back past the Dutchman. Herlings tried again at the bottom of the hill, but couldn't quite get the power down on the factory KTM, and the standing construct Yamaha rider was able to hold a tight line through the next right-hander. And this was how the race took shape for almost all of the 17 laps. The fans were urging both riders on. Jeffrey Herlings tried and tried, but in the end, it was Valentin Guillot who took his second race win of the year. Jeffrey Herlings was second, Tixier third, Jonas fourth, and Jeremy Siwa was fifth ahead of Max Anstey. But it was Guillot who won the Grand Prix, tying on points with Herlings and Tixier third, the same podium as it was in Spain 2 weekends ago. Jeffrey Herlings, though, extends his lead at the top of the World Championship standings in MX2. But what a day for Valentin Guillot and standing constructs Yamaha.
Let's just take a break in the racing action with Todd Waters. Todd, top 10 in the World Championship, best Australian, but a rider with a totally different riding style from anyone else on the grid. So if you just pop on the bike and just show us what your natural position is.
The European style is hanging off the back of the bike a lot, standing on your toes and leaning right off the back of the bike and really letting the bike, the front end, be light.
Yeah.
Coming from Australia, the tracks are a lot harder and not as rough because we don't have the 2-day format. So I've just grown up waiting over the front, coming out of the corners, pulling myself forward like in Supercross and stuff like this. So it's something that I am trying to adjust coming over here, because I do find it difficult riding the sand tracks. I need to get over the back of the bike, but yeah, it seems to be working at the moment. But like you said, we're top 10, but I'm pushing. I want to be up near that top 5, so we're trying to make some changes, but it's good.
So those changes, would you say, is in your riding style then? Is it something that you're actively working on to change that?
Yeah, so the European tracks are so rough and you tend to need to get off the back of the bike a little bit. So coming into the corners, I find that being over the front, it weights the bike like this, and the front wants to dive and you can crash. So if you watch the top guys like Hurlings in the sand, he's really off the back of the bike and really floating through all the corners. So,
but let's not forget, your GP career is only 11 races long, so you're pretty much a rookie still, aren't you?
Yeah, it is. Last year, unfortunately, we got injured, so that was my rookie year, and we only completed 4 GPs. So it's still early, and I'm continuously learning. Last weekend in Spain, we got some good starts. We had a bad one in the last moto coming down, but my starts are getting there, so I'm starting to smell the front, and yeah, it's time to go.
Absolutely. Well, best of luck for the rest of the season. Let's see if Todd can keep on pushing up towards that top 5 in MXGP Race 2.
Cairoli rocketed out of the start on his Red Bull KTM, but it was Max Nagel who got to the turn first. But it was Sean Simpson, 24, who crossed the Fox Hole shot line, clear of everybody else. Cairoli was pushed back to fifth as Fevre went through into fourth behind DeSalle. And then at the end of the lap, Cairoli fell. He lost the front end and remounted in seventh place. Nagel was all over the back of Simpson, challenging, but so too was DeSalle. Fevre also in the mix. A real dogfight between the first four riders in the early stages of the race. Fevre tried to keep at bay the German Max Nagel as DeSalle tried to close in and make a move on Simpson as Todd Waters fell. Bobrashev made his move on Nagel. And that got him up into fourth. He went after the Frenchman Romain Fevre as DeSalle made his move at the front on Simpson. Cairoli was also closing in on Max Nagel. In what was an epic battle in MXGP, Simpson got passed by Romain Fevre and then by Evgeny Bobrashev. Bobrashev moving up into third, but then he got caught by the Italian Tony Cairoli. It wasn't long before Cairoli found his way through into third place, pushing the Russian back down into fourth. With this move here at the bottom of the hill. Romain Fevre, though, was clear around about the halfway point, and he went on to take his first race win in MXGP. DeSalle was second, Tony Cairoli was third, and with it collected the British Grand Prix victory. DeSalle was second, Fevre third. Nagel could only salvage fifth this weekend, but he does still lead the championship by 4 points. Cairoli closes in as well. And with this victory here at Matley Basin, Tony Cairoli becomes the most successful winner of a British Grand Prix. Max Nagel continues to lead MXGP.
That was the best weekend's action of the year. I think you'll agree. Matley Basin never fails to deliver great action. It's a track that riders know and love, and it shows. But next week is a step into the unknown at the French circuit of Villars-sous-Écot. Be prepared for some serious French hard pack and some serious MXGP action. We'll see you there.